welcome to All Things Moore County, Moore County's weekly radio show, highlighting the many facets of the Sandhills. That includes real estate, lifestyles, community and neighborhood. And now, from Four Properties, here's your host, Bill Sahadi.
Good morning and welcome to the talk show, All Things Moore County. Dorothy, we have an unusually special show today. On two counts, we have two special guests. In the latter part of the show, we're going to be speaking with some people from Genevieve's Helping Hands, mm-hmm. which we talked briefly about last week. It was about a 34-year-old young lady who passed away from breast cancer. And her mother started a foundation, and it's a very heartwarming story. And talking about heartwarming stories, we have a guest with us today that many golfers are probably going to know. His name is DJ Gregory. They will know him from watching many of the PGA Tour and Championship Tour broadcasts. As a friend of Jim Nance's, as a young man with cerebral palsy, who in 2008 started a movement of sorts by walking every hole on the PGA and or Champions Tour and has inspired a lot of the players. DJ has started a foundation where he's giving back, and his story reminds me very much of the movie Pay It Forward, which you remember that movie?
I do remember that movie.
How it sets a great tone for giving back?
Yes.
Right? Courtney Stiles, who is the executive director of the First Tee, who's been a past guest and one of my favorite people in Moore County, who does a great job. I say that, Courtney, and I mean it. I appreciate you reaching out to us to make this a possibility today. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having us on. Honestly, when DJ and I set the date to come into town, you were one of my first thoughts, so I knew that I wanted to get him on your show, and I knew there would be a connection.
So now I'm blushing on the radio.
Yes.
I'm also being joined by a friend, John Tampa, who is a former teacher, a mentor to kids. He is kind of in retirement, but does a lot of volunteer work. Also works with athletes as a yoga instructor, helping them back from injury. Good morning, John.
Good morning. I'm so glad to be here.
Yeah, thanks for and a golfer, by the way, as well, and a very good one. And finally, DJ. Good morning and welcome to Moore County.
Good morning. It's good to be here. Thanks for having me on.
For people who don't know about your story. You've inspired a lot of people with your courage. It's a heartfelt, moving story, but it's not really a story about golf, is it?
I guess not. For me, it's you know, if you have a dream and a goal, go after it and don't let anybody tell you you can't do something.
That's right.
And I really enjoy what I do. I love what I do. And hopefully, you know, if I can motivate and inspire people in their own lives, that's pretty awesome.
From what I've read, your story goes back to the time you were 12 years old with your father.
Well, when I was 12, we went to my first PGA Tour event, which was the Wyndham Championship in Greensboro. And I'd been a golf fan all my life. I'm a sports fanatic, really. Probably the one channel I watch most is probably SportsCenter or ESPN. So because I'd watched golf so much, you know, I knew who the announcers were, and so we went to the tournament, and you know, I was really trying to look for autographs and get some autographs and stuff like that. And
sure.
And we went to the driving range, and Ken Venturi was on the driving range. And I told my dad I want to get his autograph. And at the time, I was a little bit too shy to yell out his name to get his attention. So there were some older people behind me that knew that I was trying to get Ken's attention.
Right.
And so they were yelling to get his attention. And he came over and signed my hat. And then he left. And about 5 minutes later, he came over in his golf cart and said, you know, get in the golf cart. And I was like, okay.
Oh, wow.
And he literally took me up and down the whole driving range and made sure each player that was on the range gave me an autograph, which also included Payne Stewart.
Wow.
And actually Payne signed a glove for me, which is in a shadow box in my room at home. And then after that, we went back to where my dad was, and he told my dad to get in the cart, and he took us up to the first tee and asked us if we would want to go and watch the live broadcast from the 18th tower. And I was like, sure. And my dad was like, yeah, if I have to carry him up on my shoulders, we'll be up in the tower. And
right.
So he told us, he said, well, you know, be at the tower at 3:45 because they go on there at 4 o'clock. And so he left us at the first tee, but he took us inside the ropes and told the volunteers that, you know, when each player comes in to check in to start their round, make sure that they either take a picture or sign my autograph book. And so so we did that, and then at 3:45 we go over behind the 18th green at Forest Oaks, and and there was a bunch of security there, and my dad and I looked at each other like, how are we going to get up there? They don't know that we're coming. And actually the security guard knew we were coming, and he said, Mr. Venturi's waiting for you upstairs. So it was, that's how I met Ken Venturi, and that's how I met Jim Nance.
So 35 or so years later, you now have a foundation, Walking for Kids, and each year you use the foundation to earmark different children's charities.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna correct you. It's 25 years, not 35. Oh. not quite that old.
Very good.
Not quite that old. I'm getting up there, but I'm not quite that old yet.
Okay. I am. That's my problem. I can't even add anymore.
You know, from what I did in 2008, to walk every hole and the positive response that I got from players and fans, beginning of 2010 or the end of 2009, I decided, you know, what else could I do to continue to motivate and inspire other people in their own lives and continue to make a difference. And that's how I decided to start the foundation. And my foundation, the motto of my foundation is to help kids achieve their goals and dreams one step at a time. And so the Walking for Kids Foundation helps charities and organizations that work with kids with disabilities or special needs to help them achieve their goals and dreams.
I'd like to read a quote to you that Jim Nance said in USA Today in May of 2008. Kind of puts things in perspective a little bit. It's going to take an awful lot in golf to be a better story than DJ Gregory. It's the defining story of 2008, said sports commentator Jim Nance. DJ is sending a message to people about determination and faith and vision and courage. I really believe we're all eyewitnesses to something that will someday be a movie. Pretty powerful stuff.
That is pretty powerful. And, you know, I'm fortunate to be given a platform to hopefully, like I said, inspire and motivate others. And I want to make the most of it. And, you know, to be honest, what I do, I don't work for a living. I play for a living. Because I have some of the best friends in the world that happened to play on the PGA Tour.
Right.
And the fact that, you know, what I do on a week in and week out basis can help kids, you know, achieve their goals and dreams, and that's pretty awesome.
Yeah. When did this all kick in for you? When did you make a decision to dedicate your life to giving to others? Was there a point you can go back to? When did it click in your head and then you move forward with a purpose?
Well, it's interesting because when I first, you know, it took me a while to actually do some research to find out, you know, if something like this was possible, how much it would cost, you know, would the PGA Tour allow it? Would the players be interested in it? So in 2003, I started to do a lot of research. And then in 2007, I decided I had met Aaron Baddeley in 2003 at the Arnold Palmer Invitational at Bay Hill. And we had remained friends. And so in 2007, when I decided I was going to do a complete test run on my own, I had emailed Aaron and I said, hey, this is what I really want to do. Is it something that mm-hmm. you'd be interested in, you know, being a part of? And he said, absolutely. So I went and followed Aaron for 4 days at the Arnold Palmer Invitational in 2007. And, you know, I asked him some questions. He was gracious enough to answer them. I put a proposal together. And then the next month, I went to the Byron Nelson, and I saw Jim Nance, and I had him read my proposal. And he did it one day, actually, while they were on the air. And he said, yeah, this is great. He said, have you ever thought about getting the PGA Tour involved? And I was like, no, not really. I said, this is just something that I've been thinking about myself.
Yeah.
And he said, well, I think you should send it to the commissioner. I was like, okay, really? How's the commissioner going to get what I send him? I mean, he's the commissioner of a major sport. You know, I'm sure he has his mail screened. And he said, well, you're going to put a proposal together, and I'm going to I'll hand deliver it to the tour.
Right.
And so that's what I did. And a month later, PGA Tour called me. This was in June. And so my dad and I went down to Ponte Vedra, down to headquarters. And really, they jumped on board almost immediately. Mm-hmm. But their biggest concern was whether or not I would have enough stamina to walk the golf course 2 weeks in a row. So before they would agree for me to do every event in 2008, mm-hmm. They wanted to make sure that I had enough stamina, so they made me do two test tournaments at the end of 2007 on back-to-back weeks. Mm-hmm. So we did the 2007 Barclays and 2007 Deutsche Bank Championship. And they assigned a different player for me to follow each one of those weeks, and I did a pre-tournament interview with the players, walked the golf course with them. And then after the 2 weeks was complete, and they realized that I had enough stamina to do it, then they jumped on board immediately. Mm-hmm. And so in 2008, I went to every event. The PGA Tour assigned a different player for me to follow each week. I did a pre-tournament interview with each player in which the questions were mostly not golf-related because you could find out their scorecards and their stats on the internet,
right.
You know, whatever. So I wanted to find out about, you know, what their superstitions are, what they like to do off the golf course, you know, kind of fun things like that. And then I did a blog for the PGA Tour website. And then my really, when I first started in 2008, I did it for selfish reasons, because I wanted to accomplish the personal challenge of walking every hole. And then I wanted to live out the lifelong dream of being able to go and visit some of the greatest places in the world and also meet some of the greatest people in the world.
Right.
And I wanted to write a book.
Can we talk about the book, Walking
absolutely.
With Friends?
The book talks about my experience on the tour in 2008. Kind of give some background on some of the tournaments we went to and some of the players that I interacted with that year. But mostly, hopefully, people will understand the underlying message of motivation and inspiration and never giving up on your dreams, because through hard work, anything is possible. I know, you know, in 2007, you know, when I was doing a lot of the proposals and all that fun stuff, and I was telling people what I wanted to do, a lot of people thought I was crazy. They're like, you want to do what?
Right.
You want to walk every event? And I was like, yeah, I mean, I'm not worried about it. And I knew I could do it, and you know, I'm a determined person. I, you know, if I'm going to tell you I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it no matter what. And my determination could also be known as being stubborn, because I don't take no for an answer.
We like that.
But I mean, well, it could be good or bad. And then, you know, it just kind of, I guess, snowballed in 2008. Every city we went to, there was a newspaper story, a radio, a television, whatever. Every city we went to, somebody wanted to do a story on what I was doing. And I didn't really realize until probably the third week of the year when we were in Palm Springs that I could motivate and inspire people in their own lives. Because, you know, when fans would walk up on the course, they would say, hey, thanks for coming out, and you know, you're really motivating, inspiring me in my own life. And I never knew that's really what I could do, and that's one reason why I never turned down a media request. Not because I want to see myself on TV or hear myself on the radio or read about myself. It's more of, if people can hear me talk or see my story, or even in some cases see me walk, and be inspired in their own lives, and that's pretty awesome.
We're going to come back in the second set. I want to get John's observations and Courtney's. We're talking with DJ Gregory, and you're right, it's very inspiring. Now, this is All Things More Canada. Welcome back to the second set with DJ Gregory. John, I wish every child in Moore County could sit here in person and listen to him talk. You lit up a couple of times when he spoke about determination and courage.
Yeah, I did, and one of the questions after learning everything I could about you prior to meeting you here today, and I'm delighted to do it, one of the questions I wanted to ask you was what do you remember most? What were your greatest impressions of Ken Venturi?
He's one of the nicest guys I ever met.
Huh.
Just a normal guy. And that's honestly the way a lot of the PGA Tour players are. They're just normal people. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you kind of a couple quick little stories about Ken. After the first year my dad and I met him, a year went by, and we didn't really hear much from him. And the week before the Wyndham Championship, the following year, it was Easter Sunday, and we were having dinner, and our home phone rings, and it was Mr. Venturi calling from Butler Cabin, just making sure that, you know, we were going to be in Greensboro the next week for the tournament. And, you know, he wanted to make sure all of our tickets were taken care of. And so I thought that was kind of cool. And then when I was in college, I took this class called Career Exploration my freshman year. So I was 18 years old. And one of our assignments was to interview somebody who you wanted to, you know, where you wanted to work.
Mm-hmm.
And so I called Ken Venturi, and I said, I would love, you know, this is what the assignment is. Would you be interested in doing this? Left him a message. 10 minutes later, he called me back, talked to him on the phone for 30 minutes. Then I went and turned in the paper, and my professor was like, how did you get that interview? I was like, well, I've known Mr. Venturi since I was 12 years old. So I just called him, and he was just a gracious person.
Yeah. The reason I ask is because I know if it's at all possible, I'm actually even a little bit older than Bill is. And like you, I fell in love with the game of golf at a very young age, watching it on TV. And I think I remember it was Jack Nicklaus's rookie year on the tour. And I found myself out in this open lot next to our house. And I had a baseball bat that was shaved off flat on one side. And I took an old baseball and wrapped it in adhesive tape and sunk a sand pail in the middle of nowhere, and that was the hole, and I'd slapped this ball around. I kept convincing my father that I loved this game and I wanted to learn how to play. So the first clubs that I got were Ken Venturi clubs, which I thought was pretty cool thing when I heard the story.
Mm-hmm.
What interested me to hear even more about him, and I admired him as a player back then, is what he did for you and the power of having someone take a young person under their wing, because there you were on the tee and you couldn't get pro golfers' attentions to get autographs, and Ken Venturi takes you up and down the line, and then he takes you from there to there to there, and it seems as though that's kind of the act that began it, and that's the act that you're paying forward, that you are willing to set aside whatever else you might be doing for the purpose of a greater story. And he connected you to something, and you're passing that on, and it's admirable.
Well, I mean, I appreciate it, and like I said, I look at this, I don't work for a living. I play for a living. I have too much fun.
Yeah.
I have a question to ask you and Courtney, actually. There is a connection that the two of you formed as a result, DJ, of your relationship on tour with one of the players that both you and Courtney had in common.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, each year, my foundation gives to different charities, and one of the charities we give to each year is a First Tee affiliate, because I'm a big believer in what the First Tee does, and, you know, they teach life skills through the game of golf. And one of my board members is William McGirt, and Courtney and William go back to junior golf, which I think Courtney's told me many times that she actually beat him a few times. Which is good. I'm glad to know that.
She said more than a few times.
Yeah. But a couple years ago, we were in a board meeting, a foundation board meeting, where we decide where to give the money each year. And William came up to me and he goes, you know, I'd like to give back to the First Tee of the Sandhills, because that's where I started junior golf, and at the time it was great because we had decided on a First Tee affiliate for last year, and
mm-hmm.
so you know, the board was great. They voted unanimously to say yes, and so I got Courtney's information, and a friend of mine, Steve Coleman, who is actually with us here today, I called him immediately after the meeting, and I said, just want to let you know we're going to give some money to the first tee of the Sandhills. And he was excited about it. And so I called Courtney, and I was like, you know, William McGirt kind of gave me your information, and we're going to give some money to the first tee of the Sandhills, and that's kind of started.
So you and Courtney have something in common because you're both catalysts for different reasons. I've seen Courtney in action, by the way. I've watched her coach. I've watched her mentor, and I'm very impressed. And Moore County is a very special community with lots of kids who can benefit from the life skills that the first tee teaches. And I think you've said it, golf is used as the hook, but it's the life lessons. And Courtney's not a taskmaster, but she's very consistent. And consistency is, I think, isn't that important to the young students, consistency?
Absolutely. Consistency is very important, not only with what volunteers they're working with every week to get to know those individual relationships, but to what the schedule of the day is, what the goals are. So keeping that consistency really helps them develop those life skills positively. So,
So this marriage came as a result of a mutual friend, and Courtney, your life in the golf business, and DJ, your life with the goals that you've set puts you in the arena where you are. I think it's very admirable. Tell me a little bit about your book, Walking with Friends, because it's not really about golf, is it?
Well, it's like I said a little bit earlier, it's, you know, it talks about my experience I had, you know, what I had to do to accomplish the journey in 2008, what, you know, kind of the experience of some tournaments, but also, I think more importantly, the underlying message of motivation and inspiration and never giving up on your dreams, and through hard work, anything is possible.
The first tee of the Sandhills is always needs to think outside of the box, Courtney, to raise monies, to keep the program vibrant and vital and viable for our students, and it's a challenge.
Yeah, absolutely. It's definitely an important item every year, and as our program grows and we're growing into six counties and then eventually nine counties, we're always looking at, you know, new ways to partner with individuals and foundations. So the fact that DJ has given us this additional boost last year and this year really means the world to us, and, you know, I take our donors' dollars very seriously and account very seriously for how we spend our money to make sure that it's truly focused on what we're doing with the children. So
yeah,
it's well spent, and we're very gracious for it.
Yeah, there are very few counties or very few areas like Moore County. It's a very giving community, and right now we have five different generations living here in Moore County, which is very unusual. And John, you've spent a lot of time working with athletes, horse people that were also in horse country. So you're working cross-generationally.
Yes.
And I told you, Courtney, he should be one of your first tee people.
I know. I keep telling him. We're going to get him after this.
We're going to follow up.
So mentors are so important in life. I think you were trying to make that point before with DJ. Don't you remember some of the stories, your golfing stories as a kid with your dad?
Yes.
They're indelible impressions. They never go away.
They never go away.
The lessons you've learned, me too, the same thing.
Yeah.
They're fond memories. Well, all these golfers are sitting here in this room today.
Yeah.
Tell me about your dad, DJ.
My dad, he's a pretty good guy.
He's
not bad. No, my dad's great. Both my parents are great people. They're very supportive.
Yeah.
It's always fun to have them out on the road with me when they come.
Yeah.
The different tournaments. But they've been great, and you know when I was younger, they didn't treat me any differently because I had a disability, and I think that's important because I don't look at myself as having a disability. I look at it as as I can do anything anybody else can do. Just maybe some things take me a little longer. But I don't want people to feel sorry for me. And I think part of that is because, you know, my parents treated me just like a normal person. They didn't mm-hmm. do anything differently. I look at the glasses half full, not half empty.
Right.
But my parents are great. They've been great support. And it's crazy because I'm on the road about 345 days a year.
Amazing. That's amazing.
So mm-hmm. I don't get to see them very often. So, so it is pretty cool when they come out and hang out for a few days.
It reminds me of the movie Field of Dreams. If you build it, they will come.
Mm-hmm. Well.
Well, what do you say to that?
It's like I said,
he's so humble.
I just love what I do.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, and yeah. having the chance, you know, having the platform to motivate and inspire people and, mm-hmm. you know, go and talk to different groups and organizations and being able to help out people by what I do, it's pretty awesome.
Courtney, as you go into 2016, you have a lot of programs set up, to sign up the new kids. Can you talk very quickly or briefly about the core values of the First Tee, what it is that you are trying to teach the kids that do sign up for your spring and summer and fall program?
Yes, so we are in the middle of registration for spring, which our spring will start in the middle of March, and we have 22 programs this spring scheduled across our different counties. And, you know, our mission, our short version of our mission is that we're just trying to positively impact young people. And that can be in a number of different ways, from connecting them with a mentor that's going to make an impact on or off the golf course, to using golf as the hook to teach them hurdles and how to get over hurdles and how to handle differences in life. And, you know, to DJ's point about his parents not treating him any differently because he had a disability, you know, one of the questions that we ask when a parent registers their child is, you know, if they have any disabilities or ailments or allergies, anything, and we collect that information really to internally be able to review the kids in advance, but not to treat them any differently. We don't necessarily let a volunteer know that maybe a child has a certain situation, but we just know to be prepared for that specific class, anything from bug bites to physical abilities, to really make sure that when those mentors and coaches work with them, mm-hmm. that there's no change in how they're treated.
What are the age ranges of the students that you can enroll into the program?
Our curriculum program starts at 7 years old and goes up to 17. We do have a non-curriculum program for 5 and 6 year olds, and that's really focused on getting them hooked to the game.
Okay.
But curriculum starts at 7.
And in winding down, I want to ask, where can people go online to get more information about the programs that you're offering?
We have everything available on our website at thefirsttsandhills.org. And all the information about programs and scholarships is available online. And then they can always go to our Facebook page and just search for the First Tee of the Sandhills.
And in closing, DJ, I just want to say that if anybody wants to see DJ, they can just go to YouTube and access many, many, many touching videos, things that happened in 2008 and 2009 and even earlier, just to get to know a little bit more about you. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for, you know, taking the time out of your busy schedule today and talking with us. We're going to make sure you get a copy of this podcast, and it's just been a pleasure to meet you and an inspiration to hear you speak.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, and I love, you're so humble. My goodness.
Thank you.
And what I love and what makes him such a great role model and mentor is one of his most inspiring quotes that I read was, I may take 3 steps to your 1, but I'll get there.
Right.
And that is just, that says so much.
What a great,
in such a short period.
Yeah, what a great way to end the show on that note. We wish you the very best, DJ.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
First Tee is one of Moore County's most important programs for mentoring. for role models. And yes, by the way, the game of golf is a great game for a lifetime. We'll be back in the third set. This is All Things More County. Welcome back to our third and final set today. By the way, Dorothy, thank you for playing the theme, a song to pay it forward.
You're welcome. It took me a little bit to find it, but I found it.
Well, you know, in speaking with DJ Gregory, it's obvious that he's paying it forward. And our next guest is also paying it forward in a little bit of a different way, but we're going to be speaking with Chef Jen Karlowicz, who was on the show a couple of weeks ago when we talked about the Time and Place Cafe. And Jen, you were preparing for an event, I guess a couple of weeks ago on the 26th of February. It was a benefit for Genevieve's Helping Hands and at the Time and Place Cafe. And I'm sure it was a very successful and inspiring event.
Very successful, very inspiring. We had a wonderful turnout. We had a lot of new faces, yeah, a lot of familiar faces, many friends of Genevieve's. And it's always wonderful just to get together with all of these people and talk about food, eat food, learn about food, and just
healthy food.
Healthy food. And to just continue to remember Genevieve.
Well, for those who don't know, Genevieve's Helping Hands honors Genevieve Sonya, who passed away just a couple of weeks shy of her 35th birthday.
That's right.
From breast cancer.
Yes.
And that takes most people by surprise, because I think many people don't associate breast cancer with somebody so young and so beautiful, by the way.
Yes.
She was stunning.
Beautiful inside and out.
And so your relationship with Genevieve goes beyond the Fresh Food for Families, the event that you had on the 26th of February. Can you tell us a little bit about your background with her?
Yes. I met Genevieve at our church, our Savior Lutheran Church in Southern Pines, almost as soon as I arrived in the area. She was diagnosed about a year later. And, of course, we were all shocked.
Right.
And she almost immediately hired someone to help her cook and prepare food. And when that person could no longer do it, she approached me. She knew I was a chef. And she says, I'd like you to be my personal chef.
Right.
And I said, Genevieve, I don't know how to cook this kind of food. She was on a very radical diet. I said, I'm a Le Cordon Bleu trained chef. I was trained in classic culinary.
Bernaise sauces.
Yes, exactly.
The like. Uh-huh.
And she looked at me and she goes, oh, no, I think you can do this.
Uh-huh.
And that was literally the end of the conversation. I became her chef.
She was very proactive, even after her diagnosis, wasn't she?
Yes, and she was very positive.
Right.
And she incorporated traditional medicine, alternative medicines and therapies, and of course, nutritional therapy, and that's where I came into play.
So she helped you, in a way, transitionalize a little bit your art, your craft, what you do, and how you prepare foods. What was the emphasis on the foods you prepared for her?
She was on a vegan diet for the most part, organic, uh-huh. gluten-free, uh-huh. Dairy-free, uh-huh. and we just spent several months playing around with the diet based on advice from her doctors and nutritionists and such.
Wow. So this was a... I guess you got to know her family as well. She has two young children.
Yes.
And her husband, obviously.
Yes.
So that relationship is, I'm sure, still intact.
You bet, yes.
How old were her kids?
3 and 5, if I remember correctly.
What was the emphasis of the cooking class that you held on the 26th? What were you trying to impart to people who came?
What I always try to impart is from scratch cooking, going back to the basics. This particular class, we focused on soups because it is still wintertime. We talked about making healthy salads. It can be made several days in advance for convenience. And we also talked about making healthy snacks and desserts using ingredients like dates and nuts and really high-quality organic cocoa powder and even chia seeds to make a healthy, nutritious, but tasty snack that these young families can feed to their children.
Did you, by any chance, did you do a lot of juicing with her and blended drinks and things?
We did do a lot of blended drinks, and that's also something that can be done days in advance. You can cut up apples and cucumbers and have kale and coconut
right.
water and put it all in a container.
Right.
And just every morning you grab a container and juice it, yes.
How does it happen that breast cancer can hit somebody in their 30s?
You're asking the wrong person.
I
if
know,
I had
but it is
those
a,
answers,
she
you
also
know,
looked.
Goodness.
Can I tell you from her picture on the website, she also looked a lot younger than 34.
Yes.
She looked like just a big, pretty kid.
Yep.
I mean, and sweet.
Yes.
I have spoken to her mother, Ann Rickmeyer, who lives in Long Island, and I guess she picked up on Genevieve's proactive nature after her diagnosis and carried through with Genevieve's helping hands. And it really provides resources for young women who do have breast cancer, and that's the emphasis of Genevieve's helping hands?
That's right. I believe in 2015 they provided 5 grants to women throughout the year.
Right. Yeah, they did. And on the website, there's a lot of information where people can make a donation. The Genevieve Memorial Breast Cancer Recovery Grant, I think if I'm saying that correctly, it talks about the criteria of the grant, the provisions of the grant, and the process
yes.
of the grant. There are so many young moms who live in Moore County with our changing demographics, and when you're touched by somebody like Genevieve, doesn't it change your professional focus a little bit and your perspective from what you started out as you described the rich French type foods and such?
Yes. Being Genevieve's personal chef, it really transformed what I do now
right.
for a living, and
right.
I'm grateful.
So you... your company is the Abrothacary, which is a name I love, the Abrothacary.
Yes.
And it specializes in the type of foods you were talking about, not as rich, but healthy?
Yes. I run the whole gamut with my foods. It's really what the client wants. But I do specialize in healthy cooking.
Right.
I can teach it. I can do it for you. But I also have clients that do want to learn those classic French techniques. Believe it or not.
So you actually have expanded your horizons a little
yes.
bit, and possibly as a result of Genevieve. People can go online to look at your site, because you also have an online ordering site.
Yes.
Where people can actually pick up the foods at the Time and Place Cafe.
Yes.
You work there. Explain the relationship that you have with Leslie, because Time and Place Cafe is... to my mind, it's more cutting edge, and it's a little bit more forward thinking than some eating establishments, and it's a breath of fresh air.
I agree. Everything from the decor being comfortable and casual to the concept of her community kitchen, which is what I am a part of.
Okay.
Her community kitchen opens up her kitchen space to entrepreneurs like me who do not need a full-time space. So we have the benefits of a professional, certified commercial kitchen and are able to do our craft there.
Mm-hmm.
And she also offers her cafe for events just like
right.
The cooking class. And it's just such a great venue to get these young families there because it's a great spot for them.
And teaching their kids, Dorothy made a mention. Do you remember, Dorothy, a few weeks ago?
Uh-huh.
What we were talking about how important it is to teach the children
yes.
how to cook. You as a mother of many,
yeah.
You probably are saying that with a good experience, huh?
Oh, yes. I try and get my kids into the kitchen as much as I can. It sounds strange, but especially my son, because I want him to know that he doesn't have to depend on anybody but himself to make a good meal.
But guys don't cook, do they?
Yes.
Young guys? No. We play basketball, and we're busy. We have other things to do.
If it weren't for my husband, then my children would go hungry because he does more of the cooking than I do. And he does a really good job at it.
Well, that's because you work so long and so hard.
Yeah, it's because I'm here. I'm trapped in here.
But isn't it Dorothy's point is well taken. Teaching kids to cook and about organic foods and healthy foods, they all live in this over-processed food world. People are on the run, and they're eating fatty foods. They're getting a quick sugar rush. And so many of the foods that you can buy, the overprocessed, they're harmful. They're not good for you. So you have to start the kids young.
Yes. At our home, we have a garden every year.
Okay.
And my daughter, who's 9, she helps harvest the food. She knows where it comes from. We buy a pig and a cow every year from a local meat processor.
Do you?
So we know exactly where our food is from, and I think that's very, very important.
Right.
Yeah.
So you're setting impressions with kids at a very young age, which they might not register it now, but they'll carry it through when they get older. They'll remember what mom taught them.
I hope I'm changing my family tree with my daughter.
Right.
I want her to eat better than I did as a child.
She's a fourth grader?
Yes.
Fourth grader. I'm not that much out of tune. I still remember. Tell me, you have a group of friends who were friends with Genevieve that are you all work together with Genevieve's Helping Hands. And I know Heather Kaiser is one of them, and she's a fine lady that I know. But there are others as well here in town.
Yes, there are a handful of women, and I can't give you all of their names. I know
okay.
a lot of them by face. There's a woman named Jennifer McBee. She sits on the board of Genevieve's Helping Hands that decides who gets these grants. And she's been very instrumental in getting Genevieve's Helping Hands where it is today. Of course, Heather Kaiser. And just a whole bunch of ladies all over Moore County and beyond
mm-hmm.
who give their time and talents
yeah.
to this.
If I can I read something that Ann Rickmeyer said and posted on the website about her daughter,
mm-hmm.
Genevieve. Young people get breast cancer too, says Ann Rickmeyer, the mother of Genevieve Sonya. Stage 4 cancer, breast cancer, took Genevieve's life just 2 weeks before her 35th birthday. She was a wife, mother of two, sister, friend, and U.S. Army captain. Sonya started raising awareness immediately after she was diagnosed. When Genevieve could no longer could, her mother, who is now the president of Genevieve's Helping Hands, took over. And the money raised by Genevieve's Helping Hands is given to charity, specifically recuperation grants for breast cancer victims. These grants allow mothers, daughters, women of every age more time to heal properly. The nonprofit charity has dedicated itself to helping young women with breast cancer live their lives to the fullest. Friends of Genevieve's of Genevieve's volunteered behind the bar serving customers at O'Donnell's at a specific fundraiser, and all the profits from the auction and the fundraiser get donated to help support the fight against breast cancer. It's a sad story, it's a touching story, but it's also a promising story. She's changed your emphasis, your focus, and you probably will always look back to that transition with her and what she did for you in your professional life.
I will, and I know that what she did has changed the way dozens of women all over the country change how they eat, what they put on and in their bodies, and it's going to change their children's lives too.
Okay.
So, yes.
So, talking about what we put in our bodies, let's talk a little bit about your soups.
Okay.
Because I'm hungry, and the Abrothacary Company, you can go online. What's your website?
It's the abrothacaryco.com.
And you can go ahead and order, you specialize in soups?
My soups are homemade. They're made fresh every day.
Okay.
They feature my chicken bone broth, which is cooked for a minimum of 18 hours. It's cooked with local pasture-raised chicken and delicious and nutritious.
Okay.
Yeah.
So for guys like me who grew up on Twinkies and soda pop and who doesn't – I don't cook right now – so if I want to go on, I can order some soups online and then come by the restaurant, time and place to pick them up?
Yes, you can order them online and then they'll be ready for you to pick up at the Time and Place Cafe.
Okay, you're going to promise you're going to work on something. Maybe you can do like a potpourri of things for me.
I'm going to make you a special sampler.
Yeah, I'm serious.
Yes.
And I just love the name.
Thank you.
I appreciate you coming in. I appreciate you talking about your craft and Genevieve and all the women that you're working with to help support the things that I guess she left an impression on you to make it better for people behind her.
She did. I'll never forget her.
Yeah. Jen, I will come by the restaurant in a couple of days. I'll go online today and get this done. And good luck with your community kitchen and your entrepreneurial spirit.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on.
It was a pleasure. This was a great show on two accounts, talking with the First Tee and with DJ Gregory, and talking with Genevieve's Helping Hands, all about a 34-year-old woman who passed way too young and the people that she touched. Have a great week, and we'll speak with you next week.